Okay, I think it's enough of the musical introduction. Maybe we should switch up a little bit later on. But we are live. I'm here with the distinguished co-host, T. Matthew Phillips, coming all the way from Nevada, right?
Beautiful downtown Las Vegas, Nevada.
That's amazing. And we also are joined here by the hero of the, I don't know what time period, the last week for sure, and certainly more, James Kelly. The one and only.
I didn't quite qualify as a hero, but today is day 9 of my incarceration. I'm in solitary, in theory. I'm actually in a public library right now.
Amazing. So, James, thank you very much. James, Jim, you know, I'm familiar. I know you for, I stopped counting. You know, you were very influential in my past and my decision to go public. So I know you as Jim, but I think thousands of people who watched my coverage and other people who chimed in, Marian Petri did the live and many more people whom I mentioned, maybe you will mention, were very closely following your case. I see that people are joining us. We're getting comments. And as I mentioned, as we mentioned every live stream, you know, we're trying to make it as interactive as possible. Maybe in the future, we'll just open the phone line, right? I think, it can be very interesting, but we are getting comments, we are getting views. A true panel of patriots. Thank you for the comments. So that's a beautiful way to start. Jim, so, you know, I think a good segue for us to jump into, more thorough discussion would be just a description of what happened to you, to those who haven't followed or maybe didn't follow that closely, what transpired last week.
Last week, I was in court on behalf of a woman, Tracy Arms, who is a victim of domestic violence at the hands of her ex, an attorney. And she did not feel safe being in that courtroom. She wanted to make sure that, at the very least, the transcripts had integrity. And unless there was independent recording that she could compare the transcripts to, there was no way for her to be assured of that, because quite honestly, she's so traumatized that her memory, you know, on a good day is less than perfect. It's certainly not evidentiary. And under all the stress and trauma of being there with the perpetrator of her domestic violence, her ability to remember what happens is markedly poorer. So she had wanted me to go into the court with her, and I did as a recording paralegal and filed the notice of special appearance with the clerk, who tried to refuse it. Went up and
Jim, sorry, I have to stop you for a second. I think there's something that with your mic, maybe we have some static noise. Maybe you can see if anything just
is it better against it, maybe.
Yeah. It sounds like maybe just a piece of fabric, piece of fabric or something like that. Because we are joined by people, and I want every word to be coming through as clearly as possible.
All right. There might be different pop-ups that happen, and I don't know how to shut that off. But apart from that, we shouldn't be having any kind of
now we can see, we can hear you perfectly and see.
All right. I'll just lean a little closer.
Yeah, maybe just a little closer. Yeah, excellent. So sorry about that. So please continue. So you were with Tracy Arms.
Right. And I filed the appropriate paper. I told the court officers that I would be doing this. So there was no surprise. There was no exigency at all. They knew exactly what I was going to be doing. And I filed an audio video application with the court as well, just to make sure that every piece of paperwork that could possibly be filed was. I cited New York State Civil Rights Law Section 79P, which allows us to record peace officers. All court officers are peace officers. And of course, that's in performance of their law enforcement related duties. Now, to understand that a little bit better, because 79P is vague, I referred to 29 CFR section 553.211, which is labor law and applicable. And it certainly says that given that particular view of the statutes as they're written, I have a reasonable statutory right to record in that courtroom. Now, I wasn't going to publish or broadcast to anybody beyond my client. If the court ordered that that I was to share it with the other parties, that's fine. That's not a problem. There was no intention to broadcast beyond that point. Unless, of course, there were high crimes, misdemeanors, or judicial misconduct, in which case, well, then, of course, it would be appropriate. So I went into the courtroom and started recording. It was brought to the judge's attention. The judge turned around and handed a written order, didn't allow me the time to read it, wanted the phone shut off, started accusing me of interference with governmental administration. And certainly the pressing of a record button on a device does not physically interfere with governmental administration. Can't. But yet that's what he's accusing me of. All right. So at one point I stopped the recording to try and clear that. And then he went as far as to look to have me delete it. Well, now my stubbornness set in, and I said, no, we're restarting the recording. So I restarted the recording with the intention that he would either stand down or I'd walk into jail, one or the other. And I was perfectly at peace with that. As a matter of fact, I was so much at peace that when he ordered me held in summary criminal direct contempt, I thanked him. I literally said, thank you, Your Honor, because he gave me a standing in federal court. And he may not have realized it, but he denied me my due process right of being heard. He denied me right of counsel by sending me right in. And when I was in jail, because of these glasses being metal framed, they took them away from me. And that was an ADA accommodation issue. It was also a right of access to court issue. And I didn't know it when I was in solitary, because we've got 10 days of solitary here in New York, 23 hours locked down in the cell, 1 hour out. But there was a firestorm that was occurring that I didn't really realize and that I am so very appreciative of. I was in no position to get myself out. I was, you know, just resigned to the fact that I wasn't going to get my glasses. I was going to spend the 30 days in there. I couldn't even get as far as sharpening a pencil. But come 3 days in, not even 3 days in, 55 hours in, they said, get your stuff and get out. And that came as quite the surprise, because my glasses apparently went to court without me. And I am still waiting for the transcripts to hear what they had to say.
Yeah, that's an amazing story. Yeah, you said stubbornness, you know, but I think it's more your constitutional adherence. Everybody here in New York knows you as probably one of the most knowledgeable, if not the most knowledgeable pro se litigants. You know, I personally think that.
Thank you.
Legendary, you know, too.
There aren't many people that'll walk into jail just because they think that's the right thing to do. It's not the first time I've done it. It might not be the last time I've done it. I chose not to do it a second time this month because I was in court for somebody for that exact same issue yesterday. So this isn't something that's going to fall on the mootness doctrine because it's going to continue coming up. And I think one of the important arguments that I make is that recording devices are protected under the Second Amendment. And they are in complete compliance with the District of Columbia v. Heller 2008 Supreme Court decision, in that they are defensive arms that prevent the erroneous or tyrannical deprivation of rights. Where'd everybody go?
No, I just I put you as a solo layout so people can see. I think it's important also. That's why I think these live streams and, you know, videos are a very important tool. I subscribe, you know, I completely agree to your argument that we need to utilize the technology that we have. And these streams are part of the technology, right? So before, you know, who could afford that? You would need a studio, you know, $1 million equipment. And now you can focus. And when people see your face, people see your demeanor, people see your behavior, the way you present yourself, Jim, it's unbelievable how a peaceful man with, you know, sorry for saying it, with white hair, I'm getting that soon, you know, can be held in any type of contempt, you know, some sort of violent behavior, because that's the ostensibly the reason, right? That's the rationale behind the legislation. And it's important for people to see that, right? With the panel here, and thank you, Tamilu, for saying that, true panel of patriots, you know, but we are peaceful people, peaceful, reasonable people who are pushed into unreasonable situations. Matt, you have any comments based on that? And I have a lot of, directions that we can potentially go through, but please.
There's so many things I was wanting to say here. Was there, if I could ask a directed question here at James, was there any, did the judge give any opportunity for you to cure the problem, or were you alerted that what you're doing is wrong and you should not do it? Or was it just, I thought you had said summary sort of finding by the judge and a summary conviction, if you will. Is that what happened, or did anybody give you an opportunity to turn it off, or would you have?
There was, he gave notice multiple occasions that I was to turn off the recording. He did not explain what the ramifications would be if I didn't. He gave no opportunity for me to defend myself as to why I was doing what I was doing. It was basically that I needed to acquiesce to what he said. And my opinion is that the way he approached it with respect to contempt would have been wrong. I should have been charged under New York State Penal Code Section 215.50 sub 3, second degree criminal contempt, if he really felt that I was in contempt, and then I should have been arraigned. But instead, he remanded me directly from court, and he denied two of three of my elements of procedural due process in doing that. As a matter of fact, he also went against the rules of the court to do that. And in New York State, we have something that is probably a little unique. We have something called New York State Judicial Law Section 750, A sub 6 sentence 2, which prohibits the exercise of the power of contempt to punish for a true, accurate, and complete account of what happens in court. Now, there's a case from 1895 that I do not remember off the top of my head that was actually the basis for that exact language, but it also rests on the jurisprudence of the 1826 impeachment of federal judge James H. Beck, the Crown versus Zenger, New York Supreme Court, 1735, and Cato's letter number 15. So for the judge to exercise any discretion to find me in contempt was well beyond his jurisdiction statutorily.
Yes. That's a terrific analysis, I would say, on your part also. But I'm kind of curious, when you said you'd made an initial request to do the recording. And I guess I want to ask a leading question here. What kind of bureaucratic resistance did you receive when you made the initial request in writing?
Well, I initially filed a notice of special appearance, and it was quite a comprehensive notice. And the clerk said, oh, I have to have the supervisor approve this. And the supervisor, I'm sure, made a call to the judge. And, you know, about 15 or 20 minutes later, the supervisor comes out to say, I can't accept this. And I just turned on my heel and said, that's nice, and walked away from her. Because that's it. As far as I'm concerned, it was submitted. And then I handed the audio video application upstairs, which was essentially a very abbreviated version of that, explaining exactly what I was doing and why I was doing it, and specifically wrote that I had immunity, just like the judge has immunity for first and third degree criminal coercion against my right to record. I have immunity from contempt pursuant to that statute. He didn't like that, so he decided he was going to find me in contempt. Mistake.
That's I got to say, it's also, I have to say, you're a very, obviously an educated man, very intelligent, and you're well spoken. And it's just hard to believe that something like this could happen. But we're glad to see that you're back, though, certainly. And also, you'd mentioned the Second Amendment argument. Could you expound on that, the Second Amendment argument as being a legal grounds and justification for you to have the cameras in the courtroom?
Jim is
Sure.
smiling. That's his favorite topic. So you just
Well,
play
I make three basic arguments. The first one is procedural due process. And the procedural due process is an absolute right that says you have the right through procedure to appeal, and that's based on the certification of the transcript is accurate. And unless you have an actual recording, you can't do that. So you're being deprived of your absolute right to procedural due process. And no judge has the jurisdiction to do that. So that's number one. Number two is the Second Amendment issue. Now this, let's see, do I have it here? I had it here, sorry.
Let me bring you forward
Here we go.
so
Get a
let's move
warrant.
forward.
That's my fault.
Can you show it again? Yeah,
Get a
you're
warrant.
right. Excellent.
That just reminds them that if they're going to try and get into my phone, they need to go and get a warrant. And I believe that's Riley v. California, 2014, if I
Yes,
remember correctly.
there was a case where somebody had a warrant. I remember this now, a warrant to get a cell phone, and the scope of the warrant allowed law enforcement to seize the cell phone, but then later they downloaded and they went into the information, and that act was beyond the scope of the search warrant. They needed essentially a second search warrant to retrieve the data on the cell phone. So I think it's marvelous that you quoted that case and are familiar with it. I think it's outstanding.
And when I go into court, I have a burner phone. That's the only picture on it. That's my screensaver. And it makes it abundantly clear that you need a warrant. So the decision in Heller said if you can hold something for your defense, that's considered an arm. It doesn't have to be a firearm. It doesn't have to be, because if you read the Second Amendment, it says the right to bear arms. It doesn't say the right to bear firearms. The right to bear arms shall not be infringed. And this is an arm. It's not something I could hurt you with by throwing it at you, at least not seriously. But by recording, it certainly is a tool of defense to defend against erroneous and tyrannical deprivations of rights, which is the basis for the Second Amendment is found in Federalist 29, exactly for that purpose.
Wow. I have to say, I am so impressed, and I think that's a brilliant argument. I've heard people, when it comes to the Second Amendment, making the argument that the right to keep and bear arms means shoulder weapons, but not handguns. I think that was part of the Heller argument. But the way you're expressing it with a cell phone, I think is brilliant. And God bless you. That's total rock and roll. I love it.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And to be honest, the Office of Court Administration in New York is well aware of my arguments. I've made them. I have walked into court proceedings and recorded both openly and surreptitiously. And I've notified the entire New York State Legislature that I've done this. I've notified the entire upper echelon of the administrative judges, the chief judge of the state that I've done this. And I've openly invited. If you think what I've done is wrong, give me an arrest warrant, a bench warrant. I'll answer it. And they never wanted to, but now they've stepped into it because this particular judge just wasn't able to control himself and decided he wanted to put me in. And I even went as far as telling the court officer. Well in advance, I explained because I'm big on educating and I would rather keep the court officers out of it. but I explained New York State Civil Rights Law Section 79P. I've sent notice of liability to the entire upper echelon of the New York State Unified Court System well in advance. And it had a fee schedule for the deprivation of my rights. It had a notice of offer to contract where the meeting of the minds applied on the condition of the violation of my rights in their personal capacity, not in their official capacity, but in their personal capacity. So that's wow. That's going to be an interesting argument when I make that in federal court. However, I went as far as acquiring the New York State Court Officers Rules and Procedures Manual so that I could cite from page 4, specifically section 1.30 sub B, which tells them specifically how to deal with an unlawful order. Now, the Office of Court Administration has a policy and procedure in place such that if somebody is found to be recording in a courthouse, they are to be asked to stop recording. And if they fail to do so, then they are to be asked to leave. And if they fail to do both, then they are to be arrested. For what? Trespassing? That's not applicable. So they were never able to give me an answer as to what that arrest was supposed to be for. And I think it's because they didn't have a good answer. So I made the argument well in advance to the court officers that they should stand down for these unlawful orders. They should mm-hmm. refuse them. And what I was trying to do is facilitate a discussion between the chief court officer of the state, Chief Magliano, and the chief administrative judge of the state of New York, Joseph Zayas. And I don't know that that has come to pass, although it should have. I've been very vocal about that. And yet I was arrested. Okay. I'm not afraid to walk down that path.
I have to say you are certainly a brilliant and astute man. And, you know, I think the reason it seems to me their only motive to do something like this would be the intimidation, sort of a terror tactic, if you will, the strong arm thing. It's as if that's the only response that these people can muster is to resort to violence and try to overpower those with whom they disagree. And I think that's abhorrent. And I have to say, good for you. I think it's absolutely brilliant. And you're such a well-spoken individual. It's just so hard to imagine they would even try to attempt this on somebody like yourself, you know?
Well, thank you very much. I do disagree with you. And here's why I disagree with you. I do believe the underlying issue is not merely just ego and power. I believe that they are very, very afraid of the incidental preservation of evidence of judicial misconduct, high crimes, and misdemeanors. And mm-hmm. it is for that basis that they are universally refusing to allow any kind of recording devices. I mean, I'll give you an example. Yesterday, I was in the Brooklyn court for a different case. And I was very clear with the captain what I was doing, why I was doing it. I filed the same paperwork. My paperwork is thorough. I filed yesterday, actually the same day, in that first case, objections in point of law. Very thorough. So I walked into this case. I explained what I was doing, why I was doing it. And he ended up, as a function of the order of the judge, taking everyone's cell phone and any kind of recording device before they walked into the courtroom. I said, well, that's a deprivation of the Fourth Amendment, because you have no reasonable and articulable suspicion that a crime has been, is being, or is about to be committed, even if I were to tell you that I'm going to walk into court and record. And I've done that before. I've actually had that conversation in my own case with a court officer, and I followed it up with, and that's exactly what I'm telling you I'm going to do. And he said, well, I can't let you in. You either have to give up your and I'm going back to my case at this point. But he said, you either have to give up your camera or you can't get into court. I said, well, in that case, here's what I want you to do. I want you to go into court and make sure that you're going to be indemnified for the federal lawsuit that follows. I'm going to sit down here on the bench, fill out my notice of claim, and we'll meet back here in 5 minutes. Sound good? And he said, well, yeah. And he goes into the courtroom and he comes out. And 5 minutes later, he says, Mr. Kelly, just go right on in. I start up the camera. I walk in. And for the second time in front of New York State Supreme Court Judge John J. Leo, I walk in there recording. The man runs off the bench the second time because he's that afraid of it. He knew he couldn't arrest me, but he ran off the bench. So yesterday in Kings County, I wasn't looking to get arrested the second time in the same month. I wanted to cut myself some slack. So I didn't push it quite that hard. But the court officer literally took everybody's camera, vouchered them, everybody's cell phone, and gave them a yellow copy of the voucher because it's a two-part form. And then when you came out, they put the two back together again so you could sign, and they wouldn't let you keep a copy, the underlying copy. They wouldn't even let me take a picture of it. Because once I had gotten my phone back, the voucher was complete. So that was interesting. And that will be the subject of a notice of preservation of evidence and FOIL request. But this isn't going to end anytime soon, and it's not going to end well for them. They're going to look to try every dirty trick in the book. And I'll just keep doing this until I overcome every dirty trick in the book.
That's fantastic. You know, another thing I was wondering, you mentioned you'd spoken with the law enforcement. And, you know, as far as I know, law enforcement, whether it's, you know, people in the army or people just, you know, cops on the street, sheriffs, if they receive an order that they know is unlawful, they have a duty to demur, to not obey it. And Have you had these discussions with law enforcement? Do they recognize that, or what has their reaction been?
I have been incredibly clear with them. I have an excellent relationship with them, but their position is I've got to follow orders. And of course, there's the issue of exigency, and there's the issue of good faith. And because I noticed them last month on liability in a very clear, thorough written document, there's no exigency. None. In terms of good faith, the same thing. I stripped them of good faith. So now it's just willful disregard of everything that I've done, and I've tried absolutely every which way that I could to protect them. And here's the problem. I have immunity under New York State Judicial Law Section 758 sub 6 sentence 2. The judge has immunity because the Supreme Court in 1871 decided to go with Bradley v. Fisher 7 months after they passed the Ku Klux Klan Act, the Civil Rights Act of 1871, with the notwithstanding clause that the Supreme Court still has to this day never opined on. So they bestowed upon themselves judicial immunity, which I believe is not in accordance with the will of the people, at least in 1871. And they'll always cite Stokely Sparkman, 1978, citing Bradley v. Fisher, 1871, December 1st. And I don't have a lot of patience for that. But okay, fine. Now, the court officers, they have the weakest immunity of all. Their immunity starts with Ex parte Young, 1908. It's limited by Shure v. Rhodes, 1974. Wood v. Strickland, 1975, Harlow v. Fitzgerald, 1982, and Tanzin v. Tanzier, 2020. And they cannot go beyond the bounds of their jurisdiction, their lawful jurisdiction. And there's a little bit of gray area with exigency. There's a little bit of gray area with good faith belief. But beyond that, you can't go beyond your jurisdiction and violate someone's rights. And that's exactly what happened.
Mm-hmm. Amazing. Very impressive.
This is Jim Kelly, everyone. This is that's his abilities. You know, you can cite case law and statutes from memory, and they don't like it. You know,
they don't like having me in the courtroom.
Yeah. I haven't seen many seasoned attorneys who are able to do that. So, and you're clearly an expert on the topic.
Yes.
Yeah. So that's absolutely amazing. I want to pause for a second because I want to recognize people who are participating and actively sending comments and questions. This is important. And I think it's representative of how pivotal the subject that we are discussing here, Matthew and I, every week, hopefully, and making it a routine. And Jim also was prominently featured. I actually have a ticker here, right? So James Kelly is free running. So yeah, I think it
was great. I was able to
free at last.
I walked up to my own free James Kelly rally.
Yep. And
I was wearing the actual jail outfit, and then I walked into court and I actually court watched. You should have seen a look on the court officer's face when he saw me.
Yeah. No, that's amazing. So we are joined, of course, Matthew is from California, licensed California, currently in Nevada. So that's in itself, right? We are cross-continent, but we are completely on the same wave, completely on the same page. But just to go through the names that we have here, Mark Fishman is also California in New York. Who is John? John is a fellow New Yorker. RJ Andrews is from Texas. Mark Escobel, thank you, Mark, for joining. He's also in California, as far as I remember. Nancy Layton is from West Virginia. So we have that just a small glimpse into, and of course, the people from all over the U.S. and also from all over the world. And we are consistently watched by a lot of people right now. So thank you, everyone. Please ask questions. We have an incredible panel here of experts. Now, if I may steer the discussion a little bit, Jim, if you will allow me. So first of all, you know, again, technical, and then let's go, you know, a bit more theoretical or larger picture. So where can people find your work? You cite a lot of, I think, you know, people need to pause and just take notes, but not everybody is able to do that right now. So you establish a very popular group on Facebook. It's called Cameras in Court Now, right? And I think you crossed the 1,000 members threshold, which is very impressive. As someone who runs another group, Fire Janet McFarland from Richmond County Family Court, you know, I think 1,000 people who follow you consistently is amazing. So I know that some of your pleadings or your filings are there. Where else?
Well, I'm looking to keep everything related to that particular issue on that site. And as a matter of fact, I'm a little bit late or remiss in putting up what I filed yesterday. That was a 200-page document with most of it was the exhibits. But I have a fairly thorough memorandum of law in there on the points of law. And one of the key things that I remember is that he said there's no specific statute, code, or something like that that says I have the right. And the reality is he completely ignores the Ninth Amendment when he says that, because it does not have to be codified for us to have a right. And so that was the very first thing I ripped apart in that particular order.
Yeah. So I think under that's my interaction with the group that you manage, is that under the files, right, people can find a lot of pleadings, right, documents that you prepared, writings, and they can cite it. I asked the same question, Matthew, the same question, but you don't claim any copyright. People can freely use it, I assume.
Oh, absolutely.
Yes.
Yeah, amazing. That's very good. Now let's take a step back, because that's a particular topic that I see myself as being on a mission with. Right, I was born in Soviet Union. As a child, you know, I remember tyranny. I remember red flags. I remember the communism around me, and it's very sad to see the same thing taking hold in this country. I'm speaking with two great Americans, and I think many people are starting to wake up. Now, what you are doing, and again, you know, from as a not as deep a learner as you, James, maybe at this point, but what you are doing reminds me of Rosa Parks. I think she did not take the order of just move, to the back of the bus, right? And she was arrested. Civil disobedience or peaceful resistance, that's part of the course. I think you mentioned that specifically. Would you characterize your actions in that color?
Yes, she's my favorite civil rights advocate. Why? Because she just sat there and peacefully exercised her rights, just like I sat there and peacefully continued to record. Let the
Yes.
proceedings be what they will.
Yeah, so you're not afraid of them, and that's the way to fight and expose tyranny. There's no other way, right? To be peaceful, to be as eloquent, maybe not everyone can, but to peacefully present your arguments and in a nonviolent way, essentially the government is acting violently, like Matthew alluded to. Would you agree?
Absolutely.
Yes. So now let's go back another step. So that's very impressive. You quote all the laws and precedents, and Matthew, is impressed as well as an attorney with a lot of experience. But fundamentally, what are we asking for? We're asking for transparency, accountability, right? You mentioned transcript integrity, which is a subsection of that. Why are we facing such resistance? I love asking simple questions. So, Congress or Senate sessions, whether state or federal level, are televised, right? You are allowed to record the police activity when they're on duty, right? And in fact, it actually that transparency that it brought uncovered a lot of injustices that take place, right? So the executive branch is subject to the same scrutiny. Why not judges? In my personal opinion, the proceedings in family court have to be super scrutinized beyond the any other governmental actions, because they are taking our children, right? The same courts also decide not only custody or visitation matters, they decide questions of adoptions, of termination of parental rights, right? Why the public shouldn't be allowed to scrutinize that? The judiciary branch, and there's a famous quote by multiple jurists actually, that it turns out to be the most dangerous, and that's what we are seeing right now, because that's where the rubber meets the road. You can legislate whatever laws you want, right? But bottom line is the pen that the judge holds. And as you mentioned, the uniform wearers, they just follow the orders. And we heard this phrase all over history. I'm Jewish, so that resonates particularly with me, just following the orders, right? And that's the lesson that's what you're hearing. But why the judiciary is so resistant?
You were citing from Federalist 79, or at least touching upon that as a basis, where we should have nothing to fear from the judiciary by itself, but everything to fear by its union with either of its other two coordinate branches. And that's exactly what we have right now, is its union with its other two coordinate branches, in that the separation of powers is blurred, it's erased. Because we, the people, as grantors of the Constitution, and I do see the Constitution as a revocable trust document, we, the people, as grantors, have allowed our trustees to, we've waived the right of loyalty to only us. And what am I looking for? I'm sorry, I'm tired. We've undermined our own system of checks and balances because we've allowed attorneys into the legislature in dual positions of trust. And that has destroyed the entire system. So now we have attorneys, the bar, across all three branches. And forget about the parties. The bar has become this what am I thinking about? This aristocracy, this risen aristocracy that controls the judiciary. And the answer to your question is fundamentally that any recordings in court, well, that would necessarily preserve evidence of judicial misconduct, judicial high crimes and misdemeanors. And they don't want that. And they know it's going on. They just don't want that. And if you were a tyrant and you could exercise tyrannical power to stop that from happening, why wouldn't you? Of course you would. That's what you do. You're a tyrant. So I'd like to be wrong on some of these points, but if you actually look at it, we the people, I can argue that the executive branch is corrupt, the legislative branch is corrupt, the judicial branch, I have no problem arguing, is corrupt. And we the people, don't know our rights. We don't know how to lawfully enforce them ourselves, and we're afraid to try. And I think that is fundamentally a major issue.
Afraid to try. Yes, people are afraid.
Yeah. I mean, how many people would walk up and do what I did last week?
Not many, but that's how change is made.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It takes Rosa Parks and a whole bunch of others. So
Rosa Parks and James.
I walked in, I did that, but it's something that I clearly can't do alone. It's got to have a wider support. And
you were not alone. That's actually another topic that I want to touch upon.
This is true. I didn't realize I wasn't alone from inside until they started going from cell 34B to Mr. Kelly. It's like, okay, wait a second. Somebody's having an effect here. That was an interesting switch inside.
Yeah, so I see Farah joined. I see Viridiana from Texas also. Katie's here. Jamie Marie is here. I think also from Texas, right? Please correct me if I'm wrong. So thanks, everybody. We are getting a lot of engagement. So thanks everyone. So, Jim, let's take another step, into direction that I think Matthew also likes to cover. But you were freed, which is amazing. You called it the Hanukkah miracle. As a God-believing Jew, it's important that we see the miracles and recognize them because, the ultimate power is not ours. And it's important to remember that you need to trust that people will come to your help, and that's what happened. So, but you were supposed to spend 30 days, as you mentioned. In fact, throughout the holidays, right now, we wouldn't be able to do what we are doing. But you surprisingly were freed. Now, when you and I talk, and thank you again, for granting me the exclusivity. We still didn't know the mechanics. Later on, you obtained the actual order that released you, and as far as I remember, please correct me. It was upon court's own consideration that the judge, maybe we should mention his name, right? Is there any issue with
Alfred C. Graf?
Alfred C. Graf, yes. He was a politician, according to my research. He served as an assemblyman, right? And he moved around the political establishment, nomenklatura, as it was called in Soviet Union. Now he's a family court judge, jailing people, right? So that's he released you essentially autonomously after 3 days. Now you were there in complete darkness. Let's just put it on the record. But you were not assisted by an attorney. You had no chance to speak to anyone, right? There's no arraignment
Have a conversation with an attorney who's a friend of mine. He has absolutely no expertise in this area, and we basically just bounced ideas off of each other. His experience is in a completely different area of law. So for him to say that, yes, he's representing me as a criminal attorney. No, he got through to me because he was an attorney, but that was about it. I did mention the issue with my glasses as among them and discussed the different points. I discussed, filing a habeas corpus. I discussed filing an Article 78. I discussed federal lawsuits, and I made it very clear within the jail that, A, I'm going to educate the population that I'm with once I'm out of solitary, and B, this is certainly going to be a federal lawsuit. There's no question. So
I'll tell you what I'm trying to get to, because, I think it's important for the conversation and so, for the people who watch us later on, because it's a very uplifting moment. I think it's, from the morale perspective, what happened and the release of you was a very significant I would say threshold that we as a loose community based on social media and internet were able to achieve, because there was no formal paper that you filed. There was there was no habeas corpus pending anywhere, whether in state or federal court. You were just told you are out. Now I'll tell you, because I was on the outside, right, and I'm not the only one, of course, right. But the moment we got the news that you were jailed, right, I got the call from Tracy and another court watcher, Ila Evans, who was there, right? And James Fegel, who was also there, I contacted him later on. So the importance of court watchers, again, is emphasized in this moment, because people knew what happened to you. If you are alone, nobody knows that you disappeared, right? People start calling different jails and prisons, and then maybe they discover a couple of days on, especially in a situation like ours, where we're victims of family court, and our immediate family is taken away, right? So you don't have any actual family to call on your behalf, right? You rely on friends. and increasingly so on true friends who are on social media, unfortunately, because they understand the plight you are in, right? But to back, just to back, you know, to back up, you know, what happened is I spread the news out. Other people spread the news out. Tracy Arms came on my live stream, you know, later on tonight. She said she presented the facts of your case, how exactly you were arrested, right? And all of us continued to spread the news. Later on, the news of your glasses came out, right? And people actually started calling, and even before, calling, emailing. Charlie Schulz organized the protest. And this collective pressure, right? Whether it was on the jail or on the court and the supervising judge, right? Suddenly led to some sort of an internal discussion, because it's completely non-transparent entity, right? Tyrants don't like, as we see, right, to disclose what's going on within. But some sort of internal discussion happened, and they decided not to mess with you anymore. Would you concur with this, you know, high-level, discombobulated level of analysis?
I would. I go a little further, because once the glasses got out, and I think the issue of the glasses got out through the attorney that had called in, but it was something that I was looking to move forward within the jail. And quite honestly, at the point they told me, get your stuff and get out, the furthest that I had been able to progress on any paperwork was I had a pencil without a point. It was a brand new pencil and no paper. So my next step was to actually figure out how to sharpen the pencil. Okay, that was my next big challenge. My legal challenge was to sharpen the pencil. So that's how far I had made it by myself. And you know, admittedly, I could probably work my way through the paperwork myself if I had paper, but I didn't even have paper. So what ended up happening was some of the ADA advocates really started calling the jail, started calling the court, the chambers. They were looking for me to have due process. They were looking for me to have reasonable accommodations. And I thought about sharpening the pencil on the concrete. It's painted over, so I couldn't do that. That didn't even work. So
by the way, you mentioned the same glasses, right? When there was a previous event, when they didn't take your glasses.
Oh yeah, I was in there before and they didn't take them before. So this time they took them. Same jail. Mm-hmm. Just five years apart.
Yeah. One other detail that stands, I think it's important again, you know, just for people to hear, that you said that you ask another inmate, right, to read you the posters or whatever was written on the wall.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I couldn't read. I can't read without these. And if you see these glasses by themselves, I'll show you. They're thin metal frames. So they were worried about them being a weapon. I got to tell you, that pencil was more of a weapon than these are.
it's all arbitrary, you know. That's it, just to show us who's the boss. The government is the boss, right? They do whatever they want. Yeah.
What I think happened was there were two points that came together. Suffolk County Jail does not have an ADA liaison, and I believe that they're statutorily required to. So that was an issue of exposure there. On another front, there was another issue, because one of the people that I've been helping has a case before the Supreme Court of the United States. And I'm trying to work towards putting an amicus brief in on that. And he got upset that I had been imprisoned to interfere with that. And he had gotten in touch with Senator Hoylman. And I believe Senator Hoylman actually intervened with the OCA, and the OCA ended up putting a little bit of pressure. OCA is the Office of Court Administration in New York. And I think they put a little pressure on the judge. So
I have to intervene here if you have to submit an intervener, you know. I would reserve judgment on Senator Hoylman. I would reserve judgment. He led a committee hearing here in New York City on November 1st. I was not allowed to speak. Other advocates were there, were not allowed to speak. Only institutional players were allowed to speak. And he's behind. I copy, you know, my emails and my communication regarding the oppression that I'm facing with Judge Jeanette McFarland and other people, you know, in Richmond County Family Court. And it doesn't seem to be working. You know, he was not willing to hear us out at all. So I know that he promoted some sort of we can speak. Maybe we'll devote another program to that of legislation, you know, focused on cameras in court. So we can talk about that. But, you know, if he was instrumental in your case, you know, kudos. That's any help would help, would be appreciated. But I don't think that it can be attributed, you know, to him or his office.
With respect to his bill for cameras in the court, I adamantly oppose that particular bill and the sister bill in the assembly, and do not want to see those bills pass at all because they are Trojan horses. What it's looking to do is it's looking to give judges statutory absolute discretion, which is unacceptable. It is absolutely unacceptable to give them unbridled discretion statutorily.
It's politically driven because they want to televise the Trump trial. They don't want to help us in family court or children who are taken or adopted away. It's all conditioned on that. And by the way, family court is excluded from that bill.
Well, now you've got judges, you've got legislators that are looking to give judges unbridled discretion statutorily. That's not acceptable. Not even if you have it painted over with the rebuttable presumption of the press being able to do whatever the press wants. It's a rebuttable presumption. The judge has discretion. It's useless. Now, I did send him a letter just this afternoon by email. And that letter goes through and isolates what I'm looking for the Transcript Integrity Act. And I don't know if I can bring that up. And if I bring that up, does it interfere with what comes on the screen or no? Do you still see me?
You can show. So I think you have the ability to present documents. You know, we can just send it to me and I'll try to upload it. But, you know, I want to do just a quick time check because we're at 52 minutes and Matthew and I, we have like an unwritten rule like family court, you know, that we don't go usually over an hour, but we are getting a lot of engagement. So we are over 20 people. So thanks everyone. Mark Fishman is commenting a lot. James Fegel is on. So try to present, you know, if not, just send it to me. I'll try to put it on the screen.
Tell you what, I'll keep it short. There are three elements to this. And the three elements are that any party before any court or their assigns shall have the absolute due process right to independently preserve evidence of what transpires in the courtroom using the recording device of their choosing solely for the purpose of the settlement of the official court transcripts. Two, no judge shall have any discretion whatsoever to infringe upon this absolute procedural due process right, nor shall any officer of the New York State Unified Court System have the authority to seize, voucher, or remove the defensive arms commonly known as recording devices protected by the Second Amendment from parties before the court or their assigns in any manner. Three, such recordings shall be maintained as private and shall not be published beyond the parties before the court, except by judicial permission or as evidence of judicial high crimes, misdemeanors, or judicial misconduct in remonstrances for initiating impeachment proceedings. That's pretty much it in a nutshell.
Let's see what he responds, because, you know, all my emails to him and his staff went ignored. They were ignored, so ignored. So we'll see how it goes. You know, I fundamentally, I don't trust the politicians. I think, you know, If it helped in your case, and probably we need to create some you know, coalitions. I had an offline discussion about that with Mark Fishman, but the ADA angle certainly played the role, right? But again, my favorite topic is to take a step back, and I think it played the role because it serves the agenda, and the agenda is the same, dividing and conquering. So now they're pitting people who have disabilities against people who don't have disabilities. And good that it helped you out, but that's not how it's supposed to work. Anyone and everyone are supposed to have access to court records, you know, to freely observe, right, freely record, regardless of their ADA status.
I will point out that in the federal courts, you have both the transcript and you can file a form AO-436 to get the digital recording of what transpired in the courtroom so that you can compare the two. that is not available in any way, shape, or form in New York State. As a matter of fact, in the People v. Sellers 2021, and there was no appellate decision on this, but the trial court ruled that you could not access the court reporter's recording, even if the court reporter made one. You just couldn't have that as discovery. And so that's just so fundamentally egregious, in my opinion, because court reporters are humans. And I've seen transcript after transcript compared to recording against recording, and they don't match up. And in some cases, there's substantial differences. I'm going to cite Tawan Towns v. Alabama, certiorari denied Supreme Court of the United States 2018. Justice Sotomayor's decision. That man's life hung on one word. And there were two transcripts. There was one recording that was lost. That's wrong. There always needs to be an independent recording.
What about in camera? You know, the judges are interrogating our children, right? And you, at least in New York, you're not allowed to have any access to what was said. You pay for it if you appeal, right? For the appellate division, ostensibly, to look at that. But you, as a parent, you are not allowed. What more, you know, communism-like is than this particular fact? That some sort of government official wearing a black robe with another government official at the AFC, right, sits somewhere in a government building, interrogates your children, God knows what was said, right, and you will never know.
I'm going to try and keep this short because I know we're short on time, but there are other systemic deprivations. There's the deprivation of the fundamental right to marry, the freedom of speech, the right to contract, the freedom of religion, in that the state of New York requires a marriage license. That marriage license was based on the substantial state interest of maintaining racial purity in 1906 when it was introduced, and it went into effect in 1908. That ended on June 12, 1967. So now there is no substantial state interest. Your rights are deprived under color of the law without due process, serving no greater public interest, and then they're sold back to you in a constructive fraud. So the judges, the state Supreme Court judges, are accessories after the fact to that fraud and to the deprivation of rights. Under Ex parte Young, they should lose their jurisdiction. Now, with respect to family court, the systemic deprivations there are based in the Supreme Court decision of Toomey v. Ohio, 1927. Where judges are the personification of the state, and the state has a substantial pecuniary interest to accumulate, to maximize access to federal incentive grants, such as CFDA 93563, pursuant to 42 USC Section 658A, and to take away kids entirely from families, CFDA 93603, pursuant to 42 USC Section 673B. So we're talking about billions of dollars that the state has and the children's rights to substantial due process are systemically deprived. This is what they're afraid of me opening the jar on. This is why they don't want cameras in the courtroom. They fear them, especially in the family courts.
Yeah, that's how they manipulate society.
That's a good point. Courts.
Yeah.
Wow.
Matt, you have a...
Just me. I wanted to find out, how was it that the glasses were considered a weapon? The reason I say this is, you know, God forbid I'm, you know, stopped, you know, by law enforcement, I'm driving, and they always ask, you got any drugs or weapons in the car? You know, I typically say no, but, you know, I have glasses on. Does that, you know, are they, and shouldn't they recognize them as... How is that in writing, by the way? Did they put that in writing, that the glasses are a weapon of some kind?
Are yours metal frame or plastic frame?
These are, I guess they're metal frame, a portion of them, the stems or whatever they are, I guess are.
Well, the issue with my glasses is that the frames are metal. And there is to be no metal in the jails. And that's something that certainly makes sense, and I embrace. There are exceptions. Nail clippers and razor blades to shave with. Those are exceptions, and I would think that glasses certainly could be the same type of exception.
Well, I would think also without them, if you can't, carry out the normal everyday life activities, you're essentially disabled not having your glasses. They've rendered you disabled, so that's, it seems to me there may be another cause of action in that regard,
Of course, I can't read without them.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
R.G. Andrews is saying it's a manipulation. Even plastic toothbrushes and shoelaces are weapons. And that's true. Everybody who watches TV shows, they know that prisoners can be very, very creative, right? So to me, again, taking a step back, it's all part of tyrannical mandates. Today they decide the glasses are okay, and tomorrow they decide they're a weapon because they have metal in it. There's no way out. You will always be culpable if the government wants to find you guilty or dangerous or risky.
Mm-hmm. Unbelievable.
Yeah. I have another question, thanks everyone for joining. We're getting a lot of engagement. I put a comparison on my page to Mayor Adams' streams. I attend his press conferences as a recognized journalist, and I see that he gets comparable engagement, if not less, than what we are getting here. So, but let's say your strategy works, Jim. And the system folds and say, Mr. Kelly, you were right all along. Go ahead. You are allowed to have a recording. My case started in the state of Washington, in Seattle. And in Seattle, the court hearings are recorded. You have access to the recording afterward. They gave me, I have the CDs still, There's a different question whether you can publicize them or not, but you can have the footage. You can have the video footage, without any issues. It's the law, they don't object to that. They have, of course, obstacles like it. But the oppression here and the oppression in Seattle is still identical. So let's say you win. That will not bring the system to its knees, or will it? What's your take on that?
Depends on what you call a win. I'm certainly stressing the system. Now, whether it cracks and I just get a little bit through, or whether it completely falls apart, it depends. I mean, it depends on what the unified will of we the people is. It's not me or you or anybody else. It's if there's a unified will of we the people, then they have to comply. Tyranny must bend to the rule of law. And otherwise, then you just open the door to rebellion and revolution.
And I think that's what they want. The government is essentially inciting a civil war, but that's a completely different topic.
Yes.
Well, they're pushing and they're pushing and they're pushing slowly, and it's up to us to push back. And if we allow them to push and to push and to push and we don't push back, well, that's our fault. And that's revisited upon our children. And so it's because I don't have access to my children that I fight like I do. And I want to leave the...
Fight marvelously, with education and patience and knowledge.
And I want to leave this place a better place for them, that they don't have to fight this same battle. But, whether or not I win, I've already won. It's just a matter of how it ends up being viewed in history. The arguments I've made, they can't defeat. They cannot mm-hmm. defeat them. And so these arguments are out there. Well, even if I were to disappear, the arguments are still there and will survive me. So in that, I've won.
Well, the arguments themselves are essentially, I'm not to downplay it, even a bit, right? But they're just a piece of paper, like the Constitution. You need a person who is willing to take the risk and promote the arguments by peaceful civil action, which is what you are doing. I think you touched upon a very important point when you said that it's very clear to those who have eyes to see the tyranny is moving forward, entangling us, engulfing us like every other cycle in history. But they're doing it slowly. Why? Because they want people to be trapped, those who are in the system, right? And to keep it actually hidden for the rest of the population. Cases like yours, when they arrest a peaceful, eloquent, knowledgeable man, right, who is, everybody can see, that's why these streams are important, that you present no danger. You're the classic example of an American who actually just stands on his rights, right? If they jail somebody like you, that stirs the population, and that's what they're fearful of, right? Mm. They, precisely these acts, they advance the agenda way more than they would like to do it slowly. That's my analysis of it. And that's why the direct action, peaceful direct action, is so important.
Well, they can't handle that. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt. I was just thinking, you know, I'll just make this one real quick. John Lennon famously said this, that, you know, they try to flick your beard, I think the expression was, and they come at you and so forth. But they just cannot handle the peaceful protest. An intellectual type of protest. They want you to be violent, because when you're violent, then they can handle you. They're geared up for the violence and they want that. But when they see an astute individual like yourself, a learned man, a man of peace, I have to say, I am so impressed. I know we're at the end here, but I wanted to say before we cut that I'm so impressed. I'm sure your children will be very proud to see this. And if they don't already know, I'm sure one day that day will come to pass when they realize what a wonderful man and wonderful father you truly are.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. I hope at some point they do realize, and I hope to reconnect with them at some point, but unfortunately it's not in the immediate future. So I just keep fighting this battle, and I'm not afraid to go through some of these setbacks. Like, okay, so you ended up with 30 days in jail. Yeah. And what's the worst thing that's going to happen? I mean, it became shocking to the public conscious that happened, and there was a reaction. And so the tyranny had to bend to both the will of the people and the rule of law. And certainly the tyranny hadn't followed the rule of law. And when they realized they had that exposure, then it's like, okay, now we've got a problem. Now we've got to do damage control, and we've got to start covering. And so that's what I think has happened. The problem is they didn't expect me to continue filing the way I'm filing. And there's much more filing to be done. And I have quite an abundant library of evidence from which to draw. So it's going to be interesting when this actually goes to federal court. And they're not going to want to hear it in federal court. They're not going to want to hear it in state court. All right, I'll just keep bringing the suits. And I will be as public as possible. And they don't want to arrest me. They don't want to see me free. They want to see me shut up and go away. And I'm not doing it. I mean, I don't care about, you know, did I win? Okay. They said I didn't win. Fine. I'll just keep going. So they don't know what to
do. You keep going and we'll keep covering. That's what we need to do. So we need brave people. We need brave leaders. I hope that, you know, everybody here, actually, we are getting a lot of compliments here, and Jim, you in particular, but I want to be around leaders, right? Because what's going on is complete insanity. It's insanity. The Statue of Liberty is here in New York, and this is a fully oppressive state that hides what's going on in the courtrooms, jails peaceful advocates, right? You know, censors us. It's unbelievable. And we have an attorney from California who's experiencing the same. That's not the America that we envisioned. You know, it's still the greatest country, precisely because we have the Constitution still. But it's being erased methodically and purposefully. That's what's going on. I think, you know, we're at a good point to finish the stream, unless, you know, please, Matthew, have any other comments. You know, we have a lot of engagement. Actually, painful to cut it, but we need to be disciplined. Maybe we'll do another stream. Justice Jane joined, and Mark is chiming in. Thanks, everybody, for your engagement. Any last words for this stream, Matthew?
Well, I just had to say, I saw the comment from my good friend Mark Escobel out in California, who referred to you as King Leonidas. I think that's an outstanding comparison. So there it is right there. Leonidas from 300. Well, beautiful.
Thank you very much. I just keep trying to do the next right thing. And I've made it so that they can't argue with me. They can't throw me in jail. They can't not throw me in jail. They don't know how to deal with me. They really don't know how to deal with me. And now they've opened the door where I have standing. And I've been looking for standing for 3 years, and they've been trying to deprive me of it. So, you know, when I got to jail, I was so thrilled. And I know that's a strange thing to say, but hey, I walked out of that courtroom a happy man. The judge didn't quite understand why. He's got to be off his rocker.
You got to value freedom, you know, more than anything else. Mm-hmm. Excellent. Thank you very much, gentlemen. I think we'll end here. We can always reconvene. Maybe we'll do that. I think it was a very successful stream. We got a lot of people watching and commenting. So thanks, everyone. Please continue commenting. We'll take questions and continue, hopefully, next week. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you both.
Thank you.